devote yourselves to prayer, being watchful and thankful, and pray for us too, that God may open a door for our message, so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ, for which I am in chains.
Pray that I may proclaim it clearly, as I should.
Be wise in the way you act towards outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity.
Let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone.
We want to speak to people in a natural and a relaxed way, but it can be difficult, can't it? Ananias didn't want to talk to Saul, Paul, the apostle, because he literally feared for his life. Who wouldn't? He wondered if God had got it right. When Paul becomes a believer, when in his faith he longs that he might talk to others about the gospel. And we would love to do the same. We may not face murderous threats, but we can be put off by the way that we've seen other people do it.
Mr. Jargon has all the right lingo, but it means nothing to anyone outside the church. He comes across as a Jesus freak, and few want to stop to listen. He sounds so spiritual, but connects with no one.
Mrs. Apology doesn't want to cause offence or get anyone to attend under false pretences. She has no faith in what she's inviting her friend to, so her friend hardly feels inspired to go.
Mr. Let me offer my friend an excuse is so timid and fears rejection that it's better to offer a way out, and then you'll not be too disappointed when your friend turns you down. As the invitation is lacking conviction, the friend wonders if the invitation is worth it.
Miss Inaccurate would make a second-hand car salesman blush. So full of confidence, she's desperate to seal the deal. By any means. At some point, the friend will probably be disappointed and become disillusioned.
We can fear that as we begin to talk about Jesus, we will come across poorly. Some of that fear is part of the spiritual battle we're in, but we could use it to our advantage to make us better. It galvanizes us to action. We want to become confident and natural in our talking.
There are many things that we might talk naturally about. Family, our holiday, friends, weekend sports, entertainment on TV. But we need to be comfortable in talking about our faith. How is your God talk? Your speaking of God. We have a wonderful opportunity when we Zoom together on a Sunday morning, meet in life groups, talk to one another on the phone to engage in God talk. What was the best thing you read in the Bible this week? How has God answered your prayer this week? What do you sense the Holy Spirit is saying to you this week or impressing upon your heart? What one thing did you take away from the sermon this week? And here's one for our current situation. What do you think God is saying to us in this current pandemic?
It's okay to talk about rugby or Strictly Come Dancing or the latest bog off offer at Aldi, that's buy one get one free. But it should be an even greater joy and privilege to talk about faith. The more readily we do this, the more easy we'll find it talking to people outside the church about matters to do with faith. We're living in a situation where the main narrative has been religion or faith is a private matter. It's been pushed to the margins of society, and as a result, we've somewhat retreated into our shells and lost the confidence to talk about Jesus. If we can't naturally and enthusiastically talk about faith with each other, then we'll struggle when we try to talk about faith to friends and neighbours. Talking about our faith to each other is about building up our confidence so that we're more confident we can answer the questions people are asking.
When we're talking to people, there are often three things that intrigue them. Why we are Christians, what the Christian faith is all about, and what the Bible has to say about certain issues. We need to be comfortable and confident in the way we talk about them.
So the first thing we want to look at is confident in my story. We're sometimes asked about why we are Christians. Some call it giving or sharing our testimony, though sharing and testimony are jargon words that really need to be avoided. Some are increasingly describing it as telling our story, as we're all interested in stories. However we describe it, we need to be confident and comfortable in the way that we tell it.
We need to be aware of our audience. Who are we telling our story to? How you tell a child a story is very different to how you might speak with an adult. People are at different points on their faith journey, and we want to wisely choose the best way of telling our story in a way that will help them. Our story can probably be told in a number of ways that emphasize different things. If we have been listening to the person speaking to us, or we know something of where they are spiritually, we choose to edit and adapt our story so that it resonates best with them.
We need to be aware of the time. How long do we have? You may have a fascinating story of how you came to faith, but the listener only has 2 minutes. You launch into your great story and the person feels trapped, unable to escape until you finish. We need to be sensitive to the time constraints we're under. It's better leaving people wanting more than dreading the next time you open your mouth because they can't get away. Have different length stories.
We need to be aware of our language. Speaking to someone in the these, the thous, and the thys of the King James Version is not exactly going to endear you to them today. Every workplace has its own specialist jargon, and we need to guard against using Christian jargon that people outside the church just don't understand. There used to be a campaign for plain English, and we should attempt to speak in plain, easy to understand English. We want the person we're talking to understand what we're saying.
We need to prepare our stories. We wouldn't speak at a conference or address a business meeting without thorough preparation. We would rehearse what we were going to say until it was fluent and it came across naturally. If these things are worth the effort, then so is preparing our story and then practicing it.
Why not prepare a 10-second, 30-second, 2-minute version of your story? If you're up for the challenge, try and be as concise as you can. But on most occasions, it's these versions that we will need. So when you meet in a life group this week or talk to someone on the phone, ask them for their 10-second testimony. If you don't normally go to a life group, ring someone up, ring me up, ring John up, and tell us. Because we're interested. We want to hear your story.
So mine would be, God challenged me as a child to follow him, and since then I've been on an adventure with God. So the second thing we want to look at is confident in his story. We're sometimes asked what the Christian faith is all about, and it's useful to have a framework to remember and work through. I was once challenged to sum up the entire Bible in 7 words, and this is how I did it, and I found it easy to remember and a prompt when talking to people. So it's creation, catastrophe, chaos, chosen, circles, Christ, cross, consummation. So creation, God made the world and it was good. Catastrophe, man chose to ignore God and go his own way. Chaos, as a result of man's choosing, man was separated from God and died. Chosen, God chose a special man to show the world how to know God. Circles, man would return to God, then walk away, disaster strike, then return. Christ, God wanted a permanent solution. Cross, through the cross we can enjoy peace with God permanently. Consummation, one day Jesus is coming back to take all those that want to be with him eternally.
You might respond and say you wanted to say something about the whole of creation being in a state of chaos, or the cross means sin can be forgiven. The danger can be that we add too much to cover every theological angle, and it becomes alien for the hearer as they're not familiar with theology. Remember the KISS principle. Keep it simple, stupid. People can always ask questions. What does that mean? Or you can follow things up later if you're invited to.
The key to the Christian story is the cross. We need to find a way to naturally talk about it. For many people in the past, they've used something like the bridge illustration. The Bible says, "You created everything, and it's for your pleasure that they exist and were created." The Bible goes on to say, "For all have sinned, all fall short of God's glorious standard." In other words, we have not lived to give God pleasure. The Bible goes on to say, "For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord." In other words, sin, not living for God's glory, causes a separation between God and man. There is a huge problem, but God wants to make a difference. The Bible says, "If we confess our sins to him, he is faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all our wrong." In other words, God can bridge the gap through our failure to live for his pleasure by forgiving us of all that we've done wrong. The Bible says, "God saved you by his special favour when you believed, and you can't take credit for this. It is a gift from God." In other words, no amount of good things we do could bridge the gap. It's only his grace, an unmerited gift, that is able to do so. The Bible says, "Draw close to God, and he will draw close to you." This is our assurance that through forgiveness, we can once again live for God's pleasure.
Find the right way, the comfortable way, the way you feel confident in telling your story of how the cross has changed you. Do it in a way that works for you, just so long as it's true. God's story can be told in so many ways, like a precious stone that has many facets, that can be looked at from different angles. We can highlight something that will be helpful, that the person we're talking to might understand.
One angle might be the ransom perspective. 1 Timothy 1:5-6 says, "For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all men." And the cross reminds us that God was willing to pay any price and go to any length to set us free from our slavery to sin.
Another perspective is that of peace. Romans 5:11 says, "Not only is this so, but we also rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have received reconciliation." Jesus is our peace offering to restore a broken relationship with God. The fault was not on God's part, but our part. Yet God took the initiative in Jesus Christ.
So a third way of describing what's going on is taken from the temple. 1 John 4:10 says, "This is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins." Atonement has been simply expressed as at-one-ment. It means that we can stand before a holy God as holy people because our sin has been forgiven. Simply expressed, as we stand before God, it's just as if I'd never sinned.
A fourth perspective is taken from the law court and is sometimes called penal substitution. Sin is falling short of giving God glory in every aspect of our living, every thought, every word and deed. We're pronounced guilty and the punishment is death. But instead of us dying, Christ dies in our place. 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 21 says, "God made us." No, it doesn't. It says, "God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God."
Another view is the victory perspective. Colossians 2:15 says, "And having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross." As the people of God, we're invited to participate in his victory. So Romans 8:37 says, "No, in all these things we're more than conquerors through him who loved us." Now, we have used some religious language to explain these five ways of looking at the cross. We just need to simplify them when we're talking to people outside the church, and possibly not even quote the verses we've used, because that doesn't come across well. We just need to find very simple explanations so people can understand.
How would you explain what we believe as Christians about what Christ on the cross means? Perhaps it's trying to distill it into three simple sentences that can be told in 10 seconds as the best starting point.
So mine would be, the Christian faith is about the wonderful love of God for us, his amazing grace in forgiving us, and the blessing of life in all its fullness afterwards.
We come to our final point this morning, confident with issues. Right at the very beginning, we want to say that we don't have to have all the answers to every question that is raised. What's more important is the right attitude rather than the right answer. The right answer with the wrong attitude can put people off and be quite damaging rather than help them to move forward. The lie we can believe is that we have to be an expert and have an answer for every question somebody might ask. It's not true. We're allowed to say, "I don't have an answer. Can I get back to you? I'll need to give that some more thought." What is important is that we exhibit a gentle spirit when talking with people.
One of the greatest challenges that we can face is when people disagree with us. Even Christians disagree on some issues. We do not have to disagree disagreeably. Rather, we exhibit a spirit of gentleness, which doesn't mean we're prepared to compromise or be less convicted about the truth.
We want to give the best answer we can give. So we need the integrity to ask what the Bible has to say about issues. What are the principles that might need to be used to think through modern issues that were not expressed or addressed directly in the Bible? Nuclear weapons. Climate change. And here's the catch. If we're talking about them, we'll be ready to give an answer when the time comes.
The last thing we want to mention is confident to ask. We pray that as we talk to people, they'll be convicted and convinced of the truth about God. Ananias had the privilege of leading Paul to make that decision to believe and trust in Jesus Christ. It's a sovereign work of the Holy Spirit, yet sometimes he gives us the privilege of participating with him. We have to be confident to ask people if they want to become a Christian, accept Jesus into their lives as Saviour and Lord, and be able to explain what that means. And we have to find a way that is most natural and most comfortable in expressing an invitation for them to respond. Then lead them in a prayer. What prayer would you most be comfortable in leading someone through when they came to faith?
Heavenly Father, thank you for loving me. I have not loved you as I should, nor lived for your glory. Please forgive me for living my way. I receive the forgiveness Jesus won for me on the cross, and I invite Jesus to be Saviour and Lord of my life. Amen.